Thank you, Dr. Hedi Tanjung, and brothers and sisters in the Institute of the Objective Studies in India, brothers and sisters in the Islamic University of Ibn Khaldun in Indonesia, brothers and sisters in International Institute of Islamic Thought in United States of America, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala qaidina wa qudwatina rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Alhamdulillah, and thank you for holding this important international conference, for thinking and thanking Dr. Muhammad Nasir for all of his contribution for Indonesia, for Islamic Ummah, and for international community also. And allow me here to deliver my paper about Dr. Muhammad Nasir's contribution to nation building in Indonesia. Brothers and sisters, nation building is a process or way to develop and improve the ability of a country to function perfectly. In addition, nation building is building or managing a national identity by using state power, which aims to unite the people within the country so that it remains politically stable and can last in the long term. Every country, both developing and developed, never stop improving its ability to protect and serve the people. Each country will continue to process and change and adapt to times and systems, both at domestic and international levels. In the nation building process, human development is a major element. Therefore, the role of a leader is very important in fostering awareness and strengthening the sense of nationality among citizens. Dr. Muhammad Nasir is an example of one of the founding figures of the Indonesian nation who built national awareness through the effort of education, politics, and preaching Islamic preaching da'wah Islamiyah. Brothers and sisters, Indonesians challenged in the beginning of independence. In the mid of the 20th century, when Indonesia became independent in 1945, Indonesia's population was around 61 million. As new plurality country, Indonesia faces a big challenge because its territory consists of not less than 17,000 islands, and its people come from 300 ethnic groups who speak not less than 600 regional languages. The main challenge of Indonesian's nation building at the beginning of the independence of Indonesia was maintaining territorial integrity and sovereignty. Therefore, the form of unitary state of the Republic of Indonesia, NKRI, was chosen to maintain territorial integrity of Indonesia. Indonesia has experienced being a federal state, namely the Republic of Indonesia United, RIS, which is easily provoked by foreign colonial nations to divide between the states. Ideologically, Indonesian independence was strongly supported by national awareness among its elite leaders, especially those leading a local youth organization. On 28 October of 1928, the Youth Congress was held, which was initiated by youth organizations throughout the archipelago. At the end of the Congress, a youth pledge was agreed, which affirmed the ideals of one motherland Indonesia and one nation Indonesia, and upholding the united language, Indonesian language. The awareness of the homeland, nation, and language of unity is a valuable asset for nation building, especially since it was agreed long before the Indonesian became politically independent. Young Muhammad Nasir became chairman of the Bandung branch of the Young Islamic Bond in 1928 into 1932. And Young Islamic Bond was one of the youth organizations actively involved in the Youth Congress in Jakarta. Nasir's other colleagues who were active in the Youth Congress were Muhammad Rom and Kasman Singwa Dimanjo, who showed the Muslim figures played a very big role in the formulation of the ideology of the Indonesian nation in collaboration with nationalist and traditionalist figures. And about the nation building via educational path, we know well that the Nasir contribution was recognized at the national level for Indonesian people and influenced relation with the nation in the 1915s. Nasir embodies the ideal of nationality from thought to concrete action. He believes that there are parallels between religious values, nationality, and humanity. Therefore, he applies Islamic idealism as a political rhetoric and character and persona, social and statehood life as well. and about his role in national building via educational path, I think many papers was delivered before. Then I would like to jump to the another topic. It's about national building via political path. In 1938, Nasir joined the Indonesian Islamic Party and was appointed head of the Bandung branch from 1940 to 1942. During the Japanese occupation, he joined with Islamic leaders who took the initiative to establish the Haji's Indonesian Council. Then Cheng became the Indonesian Muslim Consultative Council, or Masyumi. Nasir was appointed as one of the leaders of Masyumi from 1945 until when Masyumi and the Indonesian Socialist Party were dissolved by President Sukarno in 1960. His 22 years of service as a politician and strengthened Nasir's character as a Democrat, and at the same time influenced the national political constellation with democratic values in line with the principle of Islam and Pancasila, the five pillars of Indonesian ideology, as the basis of the Republic of Indonesia. The fourth precept of Pancasila, the fifth principle, states specially about democracy, which is formulated as democracy is led by the wisdom and deliberation representation. The practice of democracy in Indonesia is described under the control of wisdom insight. This is like the concept of police, city-state in Plato's and Aristotle's thought, where a city or region is led by intellectuals. It is not a democracy that tends to an anarchy because each person or group want to win alone and all kind of Machiavellistic ways. Nor is it a democracy controlled by a handful of elites who have abundant wealth, plutocracy, and can buy anything, including people's votes and judge decision. Democracy, which is led by intellectual, put forward the method of deliberation in representative of institution, not aimless debate. Representative of the people must increase their capacity to deliberate and debate alternative policies for the benefit of the people. This is where it is placed, whether members of parliament or political parties truly understand and fight for the aspiration for the people they represent. After the proclamation of independence, Vice President Muhammad Hatta issued an edict date number 3 of November 1945, which encouraged the formation of political parties as part of stabilizing the democracy. The edict was issued as in response to a proposal by an APA working body to the government. Islamic figures from various organizations at the time came together to form an Islamic political party, including Agus Salim, Sukisman, Wiro Sanjoyo, Wahid Hashim, and others. Thus, a committee was formed for the Indonesian Muslim Ummah Congress, which was held for the first time after independence on 7 to 8 November 1945 in Yogyakarta. The Congress Committee is chaired by Muhammad Nasir, who is still relatively young but highly trusted, where the committee members are senior figures. At a relatively young age, Nasir was trusted to be one of the central administrators of the Masyumi Party. Because of his important position, Nasir was appointed as a member of the working body of the Central Indonesian National Committee in 1945 to 1965. He was appointed the Minister of Information of the Republic of Indonesia in Syahrir's second cabinet and Syahrir's third cabinet and Hatta cabinet number one. As their role in putting the work mechanism of the Indonesian Ministry of Information was very prominent, especially in spreading the news of Indonesian independence and building communication between government units in times of the emergency condition. And in fact, according to Mr. Muhammad Hatta, at the time, the president, Mr. Bung Karno, did not want to send a government information if it was not compiled by Brother Muhammad Nasir. His position as a chairman of the Islamic Party, Masyumi, didn't limit his interaction with national figures from various backgrounds. He believes that the path of dialogue and deliberation will solve many national problems. His very bold initiative to submit the integration bill, the 3rd of April 1950, to the parliament, the Constituante, to end the era of the Federal Republic of Indonesia toward the unitary state of the Republic of Indonesia. All of the historic achievements were pursued through a dialogue with regional leaders who led the restates, the Federal Republic of Indonesia, not by coercion or political pressure. We collected support from all nationalist factions, including Catholic and Christian parties. Nasir has good relationship with Catholic Ignatius Joseph Kasimo and Christian leaders such as Johan Sleimina. Soon after the bill has been approved by the constituent and by the government, Nasir was assigned as Prime Minister by Sukarno as the President of the Unitary State of Republic of Indonesia. His loyalty for the Republic of Indonesia has become his main obsession in maintaining national unity and integrity at all costs. However, Nasir chose a path of dialogue and built an agreement with all parties with different views because he believed that all nation figures wanted to see a united and prosperous Indonesia. Nasir also persuaded Islamic figures who led the exil government of the Republic of Indonesia in 1948 until 1949. All the Darul Islam resistance in 1949 till 1962 to give up sovereignty and return to the Republic of Indonesia. It becomes an internal monument on how to build the pillars of national building in theory and practice. National building through the dakwah path. National building effort faced challenges not only from external foreign powers that want to divide and colonize a nation, but also from an internal aspect, namely differences in views among the driving figures.
During the gathering, excuse me, Dr. Hida, ya.
Okay, one minute.
Your time, five minutes more.
Okay, thank you very much.
Just minutes.
Okay, 5 minutes. Okay, then I would like to say that Dr. Muhammad Nasir was involved in the opposition against Sukarno's increasingly authoritarian government and eventually joined the revolutionary government of the Republic of Indonesia after leaving Java. And by PRRI, which demand greater regional autonomy, was misinterpreted by Sukarno as a rebellion. As a result, Nasir was arrested and imprisoned in Malang from 1962 to 1964. And was released during the New Order era on July 1966. After being released from the prison, Nasir was again involved in Islamic organization. After long service as a politician and public official, he founded and led the Islamic preaching organization. It is Dewan Dawah Islam Indonesia. Nasir died in the 26th of February 1967. Nasir Dawah activities were not only in Indonesia, but received the trust of foreign countries in such as Majlis Syurabitul Alam Islami and Majlis Al-A'la Al-Alamin Masajid in Makkah, and the Oxford Center for Islamic Studies in UK, and the World Muslim Congress in Karachi, Pakistan. Nasir legacy includes modern Islamic thoughts and democratic political Islam and in pluralistic nation, the biggest Muslim country in the world. The different political views between Muhammad Nasir, during the early days of the New Order, he was credited with sending a note to Tunku Abdurrahman in Malaysia in order to reopen relations with Malaysia and Indonesia. In addition, he was also one who contacts the Kuwait government to invest in Indonesia and convince the Japanese government of the New Order's seriousness in developing the country. The difference in political views between Muhammad Nasir and Suharto didn't prevent him from contributing to saving Indonesia from the political and economic crisis at the start of the New Order, but he used his Islamic influence to contact Malaysia and Kuwait. Nasir mobilized all his potential and connection with the outside world to build international trust to the Indonesian government. In fact, he often experiences political pressure. It's amazing that no politician is willing and able to make such sacrifice, except for those who are guided by sincerity and loyalty for the Republic of Indonesia because of the Islamic teaching he understands. Thanks to Dr. Muhammad Nasir, teaching program and guidance, especially in well-known university campuses in Indonesia, a generation has emerged who have an awareness of democracy and demand change. However, preaching takes a long time to bring about change. After 32 years in power, President Suharto finally stepped down in 1998 through the reform movement power. President reform movement organized by students and critical groups. One of the important components of the 1998 reform movement was activists of the Islamic Critics Association in campus, Lembaga Dakwah Kampus, which was none other than the work of Nasir and his friend in fostering the younger generation. Nasir has succeeded in carrying out a regeneration process in terms of democratic thinking and behavior while maintaining national integrity and integration by this good understanding of Islamic teaching. Thank you, Dr. Muhammad Nasir, for all of his effort, and Indonesian government offer him the National Hero Medal at 10th of November 2008. That is the life journey and struggle of Dr. Muhammad Nasir in realizing Indonesia different independent and strengthening national building by the three important paths, politically and educationally and Islamically or Islamic preaching, that has been taken by Pak Nasir in the field of education, politics, and dakwah, an inspiration or a very good inspiration for the next generation. The current condition of contemporary Indonesia shows that Muslim and Islamic organization and Islamic political organization are facing political crisis. History seems to repeat itself. Dr. Muhammad Nasir's prescription for maintaining the integrity of Islam parties in the arena of democracy and maintaining nationalism spirit is still very relevant till it relates with another nation. And thank you very much. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.